During 2020, the whole world celebrates the 250th birthday of Ludwig van Beethoven, who was born in Bonn, Germany, in December of 1770, and died at the age of 56 in Vienna, Austria, in March of 1827. As a composer, he gave the world music of towering significance, sometimes heroic, tender, humorous, or ethereal, music which is often capable of taking the receptive listener to the heavens and back. He was a virtuoso pianist, and many of his compositions feature our instrument in powerful ways, as soloist or with partners that include orchestra or chamber musicians. His output includes symphonies, string quartets, the opera Fidelio, and chamber works for strings or winds, often with piano. And of course, we are fortunate to have the 32 sonatas for piano solo, multiple sets of variations, three sets of bagatelles, and numerous other pieces, and the five concertos for piano and orchestra. Today, we have opportunity to get acquainted through this video and to think together about Beethoven. Not so much about how many pieces he wrote, but rather to look at some of the ways his music can touch our hearts. Why do we study, play, and teach the piano music of Beethoven? Why are his pieces still fresh and powerful and deeply loved, more than 200 years after he wrote them? What gives his music its power and drive? What are some of the ways that we, as performers and teachers today, can experience this music deeply and share our joy with our audiences and our students? What does Beethoven's music and that of many other great composers teach us about the journey of life and what makes that journey beautiful? If each of our lives is like a sonata allegro form, most of my students are playing their expositions. As for me, at age 72, it's definitely quite late in the recapitulation or well into the coda. Because we all walk this journey of life and music together, even on opposite sides of the planet, I'd like to share briefly a bit of my own personal journey, in part because that experience relates directly to how we can converse about these pieces and our shared experience of Beethoven and his music. I began piano study in 1953 at the age of five, not long after my family discovered that I could correctly identify, just by listening, the specific pitch name of the highest note in a soprano aria we heard on the radio. I grew up in a very quiet and peaceful country area where my parents never locked a house and routinely left the car key in the ignition at night in an unlocked garage. Although that was a great place to grow up, I didn't have opportunity to meet and be challenged by other young pianists until I entered college, and I often spent more piano time improvising in jazz and other styles than I did seriously practicing. Gradually, some connections developed, though. On a family trip to Germany when I was 17, in Bonn, we visited the house where Beethoven was born. We also briefly visited Vienna, Austria, where Beethoven spent most of his adult life. Much of my formal training was at the Peabody Conservatory of Music in Baltimore between 1968 and 1975. At Peabody, I studied piano, first with Walter Hauzig and then with Leon Fleischer, whom I had coincidentally heard when I was a small child in one of his performances of the Beethoven Concerto with the Cleveland Orchestra. Both of these amazing teachers, who transformed my playing and my life, had studied with Arthur Schnabel, who was the first person to record all the Beethoven sonatas for long playing records. Through them, I experienced a connection I still find deeply meaningful. Arthur Schnabel studied with Theodor Leschetizky, who was, along with Franz Liszt, one of the two most famous teachers of his time. Both Liszt and Leschetizky studied with Karl Czerny. In addition to being known for the countless technical exercises he devised, Czerny composed many beautiful pieces of real music. Czerny also made the statement that he could at any moment play any of Beethoven's piano pieces from memory, in part, no doubt, because his piano teacher was Beethoven. Of course, there are many other generational lineages that are just as valid. And I need to remember, each time I think about being in that sort of company, that a chain is only as strong as its weakest link. At the end of my doctoral coursework at Peabody, I received a Fulbright Fellowship that let me study in Vienna, Austria, from 1975 to 1977. I enrolled at the Vienna Academy of Music, walking every class day past a little restaurant that had a sign posted at the entrance. Franz Schubert played the piano here. During those years, I absorbed all I could of Viennese culture. I participated in European piano competitions, and I completed my doctoral dissertation, which is a book-length analytical study of Beethoven's last piano sonata, Opus 111, in C minor. I remember also that the Fulbright office arranged for a tour of the musical instrument collection at the Vienna Museum of Art History, where I saw and heard, but of course didn't dare to touch, one of the pianos that Beethoven himself had owned. In the spring of 1977, I was preparing to take part in the Vienna International Beethoven Competition, which required a wide selection of Beethoven's pieces, including one sonata from each period, a variation set, I chose the Diabelli variations, a complete opus of bagatelles, and so on. Just days before the competition was to start, the telephone rang very late one night with an invitation to interview for a faculty teaching position at the University of Colorado during the same week as the Beethoven competition. I bought a plane ticket, went to Colorado, and was thrilled to get the job. Ever since I was a very small child, I had known I wanted to teach in a university someday. So for me, it was the right decision to get on that plane and give up on trying the competition. I don't regret it now, but sometimes I do wonder. That fall, In 1977, I began full-time university-level teaching of piano, which I'm still doing full-time, now about to start my 43rd year. Teaching is one of the greatest privileges of my life. How could we not feel joy in watching someone realize that they can do and experience much more than they thought they could? The last 32 of my teaching years have been at West Virginia University. Because of COVID-19 safety restrictions, I'm recording this video at my home in Morgantown, rather than at the WVU School of Music. Truly, we live in interesting times. Interesting is not all bad, though, because today you and I can communicate and share about music, even from opposite sides of the planet. When I started teaching 43 years ago, I had already played quite a few of Beethoven's pieces. I had written a book about his last sonata, and I had completed a doctorate at a major conservatory, studying with one of the most famous teachers in the world. So I thought I knew quite a bit about Beethoven. Well, all these years later, now that I have taught all the sonatas and all the concertos, most of them multiple times, I'm a lot less sure about a lot of things. Nathan Pusey, a former president of Harvard University, defines education as the process of going from cocksure ignorance to thoughtful uncertainty. Sometimes we would all do well to be a little less sure of ourselves and to be open to alternative ways of doing things, including how to play Beethoven or anyone else. We need to guard against the temptation, which as musicians we all feel sometimes, to believe that the way we hear this phrase or that crescendo or the tempo of whatever piece is, of course, automatically the right way to play it. Being open to multiple options is valid technically as well, as there are many ways to play the instrument, including the very flat fingers we often see when we watch videos of Vladimir Horowitz and Glenn Gould. Ultimately, whatever works for each person is probably right, so long as we are mindful of the very real risk of practice-related injury for ourselves and for our students. There are endlessly varied and conflicting musical ideas, too. For example, Glenn Gould's first major recording of the Bach-Goldberg variations propelled him to fame. Years later, shortly before his death, he recorded the same set again. Both versions are amazing, and they are incredibly different from each other, so different that one could easily believe that they were made by different people. Which way was right? Of course, there are underlying principles that shape our perceptions of music in shared ways. In tonal music, the harmonic progressions ultimately govern how the material needs to flow. Rhythmic energy, even in slow pieces, has everything to do with our sense of involvement and of movement, whether dance-like and truly present, or floating far above the ordinary world. In this time together, we are going to look briefly at several of Beethoven's sonatas. The first one, Opus 2, number 1 in F minor, Opus 78 in F sharp major, and also his last sonata, Opus 111 in C minor. If one thinks of the 32 sonatas as a cycle, it is beautiful to contemplate that the first note of Opus 2, number 1, and the last melodic note of Opus 111 are exactly the same pitch, which we as pianists call middle C. We're also going to use those musical excerpts as springboards for exploring some of the general principles of musical interpretation that I have found valuable. Many of us sharing this conversation already are, or soon will be, piano teachers. Thus, an important component of our discussion today is to think together about how we relate to our students. Of course, they are usually younger and less experienced than we are at the moment, but they already love our instrument and the music we work on together. We have a sacred responsibility to help them grow, to develop confidence and understanding, to practice safely and avoid injury, and to become independent artists, ready to face the world in their own individual ways. A beautiful concept is that the teacher invites the student to stand on his shoulders, thus enabling the student to see further than the teacher himself. We have already briefly mentioned the sonatas, concertos, chamber works, and other pieces that make up Beethoven's musical output for piano. Of course, many of you already know this information and many of the pieces themselves. It's good to think about the additions we use, both for accuracy of the notes and for helpful suggestions. A good Urtext edition faithfully presents the text as accurately as possible, with minimal editorial intrusion. I prefer to read from the Henley edition myself. I regularly use two other editions as well, the Claudio Rau version, which is published by Peters, which offers brilliant fingering suggestions in a clear Urtext version, and the venerable edition by Arthur Schnabel, with fascinating notes and in the invaluable phrase length suggestions that he indicates by Roman numerals above the score. For Opus 111, I also have a photocopy of the composer's manuscript, affordably reprinted by Dover. It brings a smile when looking at that handwriting to know that there were many letters from Beethoven to his publishers complaining that there were many mistakes in the printed scores because they hadn't read carefully enough. Your copyist, sir, is insufficiently musical. We should also consider the pianos that Beethoven knew, along with the mutual relationship that evolved between those instruments and his compositions. I am grateful to have had multiple opportunities to perform on the sort of piano Beethoven would have known as a young virtuoso, what we would now call a forte piano, such as those that Mozart and Haydn also surely knew in the 1780s, typically offering a 5-octave range, F to F, leather-covered hammers, a wooden frame, and a much lighter action than that of a modern grand. These instruments are fully valid in themselves and beautifully suited to the music of their time. This is completely natural, as the music was, of course, intended for these instruments and for their individual sounds and capabilities. Here at WVU, we have a lovely modern replica of an instrument that Mozart chose for himself. Hearing and playing such an instrument can really open our ears to new possibilities, even if we only perform on modern instruments. Notwithstanding our bias towards what we know best, early instruments are not primitive experiments that would someday lead to a real piano like what we know today. The overall sound is smaller than we're used to now, but it offers a huge dynamic range and colorful pedal effects. On most instruments of this time, the pedals are usually activated with the knee rather than the foot. Typically, there is a damper pedal that works in a way that is similar to what we know today, along with a sort of soft pedal that works not by shifting the action inside the case, but by bringing a strip of felt or leather between the hammers and the strings, similar to a lute stop on a harpsichord. One adjustment a modern pianist needs to make on many early instruments is that the keys are narrower, with the result that if we instinctively set our hand for a modern octave, we'll be playing a ninth instead. The Beethoven piano that I mentioned hearing in Vienna was the French-made Erard piano that Beethoven got in 1803. It has a 5.5-octave range and features 4 pedals that include a damper pedal and several varieties of soft pedal mechanisms. The general sound was a bit bigger than that of a typical 1780 instrument. The Beethoven excerpts that I heard being played that afternoon sounded 3 half steps lower than we would have heard from the same keys on a modern piano. That's a big difference. Lower string tension, causing the lower pitch, is used to protect this fragile and priceless instrument, while also reflecting the fact that the standard of pitch in those days was often considerably lower than the modern A440 cycles per second. Beethoven's next instrument was his beloved Broadwood, sent by the manufacturer as a gift in 1817, all the way from London, England, to Vienna. It was a 6-octave piano with a Spanish mahogany case and 2 pedals, a soft pedal and a split damper pedal, which allowed separate control of the bass dampers or the treble dampers, or all of them at once. The last piano that Beethoven owned was made in Vienna by Conrad Graf in late 1825, 2 years before Beethoven's death. It featured a 6.5-octave range and had quadruple stringing for some of the notes. At one point, it also was fitted with an extra soundboard and a sort of acoustical horn that attempted to focus the sound enough that Beethoven, who was almost totally deaf at that point, could hear it, with ears that had begun to have problems already in 1798. This instrument now lives in Beethoven's birth house in Bonn, Germany, which I mentioned having visited as a teenager. In addition to the beauty of these instruments themselves, they demonstrate Beethoven's fame. Piano makers wanted him to endorse their product, so they sent him instruments as gifts. They also strove for ever bigger sounds, in part so he could hear them. The number of keys steadily increased. Of course, Beethoven then wrote for these new larger ranges, after which more instrument makers produced pianos with enough keys to play Beethoven's newer compositions. So we see an upward spiral in the relationship between Beethoven and instrument makers of his time. He even made a half-hearted attempt late in his life to revise some of the earlier sonatas, to include notes at the top and bottom of the keyboard that he did not have available at the original time of composition. There are many innovations in Beethoven's compositions right from the beginning. In his first sonata, Opus 2, number 1, the first 8 bars are fairly standard harmonically, but the next few bars take us to an adventurous new world that is quite revolutionary, especially so early in the composition. By contrast, the last sonata, Opus 111, begins almost chaotically, intentionally avoiding the home key until the second page. The piece ends with a slow movement that is almost 20 minutes of the purest C major, taking us not from stability to revolution, but from wild outcry to gentle rest. Not everyone knows that Beethoven's sketchbooks contain plans for a fugal third movement to Opus 111. Probably most of us would agree that the ending we know is just right. In Beethoven's hands, everything expands. Number of movements, often 4 instead of 3. Size of the individual movements, often vastly longer, with proportionately larger development sections and coda, and bigger, more obvious technical demands. There is often a heroic, orchestral sense of virtuosity, especially from the middle period onward. He began to introduce fugal material, especially in the late works, which is fascinating given that the early classical style developed in part as a reaction against the intricate counterpoint of the late Baroque, particularly that of J.S. Bach. Most of our discussion so far has been about what. What did Beethoven write? For which instruments? In which styles? Facts are important and useful to know. What is more interesting, though, in music, as in life, is what cannot be reduced to facts. Why do we play and teach the music of Beethoven? Because it's beautiful, or because I like it, or even because my teacher made me do it. The minute we give any of those answers, well, at least the first two answers, we're no longer talking about facts. We're in the wonderful world of opinions, the realm of feelings that can move us to ecstatic tears during a great performance of a slow movement, that get our feet moving when we play a dance movement, or that give rise to passionate disagreements about which recording is best, which tempo is right, and exactly how we should shape every phrase. And there are as many different opinions as there are musicians to express those opinions. In so many ways, the most interesting and beautiful things are those we cannot pin down to just one way of understanding them. If Beethoven writes E flat and we're playing E natural, we're making a factual error that also sounds horrible. Just change it, preferably yesterday. But how many beautiful ways are there to play the correct E flat? If there seems to be only one way, maybe we've limited our own possibilities unnecessarily. What creates the activating spark of rhythmic energy? Does it matter if, as pianists, we breathe in time the way every singer and wind player must while shaping a melody? How do we decide which way to shape that melody dynamically? Where should we move forward, and where do we take time? How should we balance the voicing of this chord? What are the best ways to shape this small motive, this phrase, the entire exposition, the dominant preparation for the recapitulation, the dramatic finality of the coda, the architecture of the movement as a whole? If each of those different lengths of thought has its own natural flow to a peak, how should we handle conflicts among these levels when it is not possible to be fully aware of each level at the same time? Which level is important? Which way is right? Yes, there are also rights and wrongs rhythmically. We could interpret a 4-4 measure as being primarily 2 half notes or 8 eighth notes, but never as 5 quarter notes. We also need to know clearly what the piano can and cannot do to produce sound, because that truth sets us free to understand more fully what we're actually doing expressively. Let's look together at the action parts which produce the sound in a modern grand piano. We spend our lives working this thing up and down, but some of us don't really know clearly what happens inside the piano. We don't have to know the technical name of every little piece of wood, but we gain significantly more authority if we know how the hammer gets to the string. Objectively, that determines what we can and cannot control about that hammer strike, and thus what we can and cannot control in the sound that is produced. When we push the front of the key down, the back goes up. Very simple. The key also pushes up here, moving this complicated triangular assembly known as the whippet. The back of the key also raises the damper. so the string can vibrate. What directly moves the hammer upward is the jack, this L-shaped piece here, that protrudes through the repetition lever and actually pushes against the bottom of the hammer shank, like that. So this is what happens when the key goes down and that goes up. When you push the key down slowly, there's a point of resistance and then a continued movement to the bottom. What you're feeling actually happens here where the jack meets the knuckle. After the jack slips away, you cannot play this note again until the jack comes back under the knuckle. This means that the most important factor in fast repeated notes is not how you start the second note. Rather, it's how quickly you release the first note. The jack only goes up this far. Notice that the hammer is not touching the string now. Also notice that when the hammer does touch the string, it's no longer touching the top of the jack. This is incredibly important, and fundamentally misunderstanding this reality has given rise to many persistent myths among pianists and teachers. We're going to come back to that idea in a moment, but first I'd like to put on my professor hat and invite you to take an easy quiz. You might want to write down your answers, even though there's no way I can collect the papers or assign grades. I'm going to play the same note three times, each with a different approach, all without any pedal. The video will go dark each time I play, so you'll only hear the sound. Your part of this exercise is to listen as closely as you can to each sound, trying to imagine how you would have played the key to produce that sound on your piano. Please also describe the actual sound you hear, perhaps with words like warm or harsh or dry or thin or purple, along with your observations about how you think I physically played the key to get each sound. Here's the first example. Please describe what you heard and how you think I did it. Ready for the second sound? As before, please describe what you heard and how I did it. Here's the third sound. Thank you for your attention, in spite of the distance. If we could be in the same room together, now I would ask for volunteers to describe each sound in turn. We would hear many kinds of descriptions for each, with some shared trends and probably some very strong opinions about how I played each note. Typically, for the first sound, we might hear descriptions like harsh, loud, tight arm, stiff finger, rough, or even violent, with a fast attack. Typically for the second sound, more gentle, warmer sound and colors, less harsh, more relaxed technically, better hand position, and so on. And for the third example, sweet sound, very gentle, pastel colors, extremely relaxed technique, soothing mood, and so on. We can't actually have those discussions in person now from a distance, but we can replay the video with the sound, showing this time exactly how I played each note. Here's what actually happened. As you saw, I played fortissimo, starting in contact with the key, with a powerful upward thrust from the wrist, using flat fingers. Ready for the second sound? This time, I played mezzo forte, intentionally using a very stiff, straight finger coming directly down from above. Here's the third sound. And this time, I played pianissimo, using a hard plastic tube cushioned by a handkerchief so it wouldn't click on the key. Is that a flexible technique? Pastel sound colors? What does this mean? Were you surprised or reluctant to believe what you heard? What you saw? Maybe you felt cheated or even a little bit angry. Those feelings are okay, but what you saw is exactly what I did. And what you saw probably did not match what you had imagined you heard. The key to this puzzle is in the distances we saw between the base of the hammer and the jack, and also between the top of the hammer and the string. As you can see, the hammer can only move up and down from this simple hinge joint right there. And there's no part of the key action that can possibly be touching the hammer when the hammer hits the string. It doesn't go high enough to touch. This means something really important. Not counting pedal or possible noise from the key itself, there is one variable, and one variable only, that you can control on any single note of any acoustical piano. This variable is the speed of the hammer at the moment it flies freely to the string. According to the laws of physics regarding vibrating strings, a faster hammer stroke means a louder sound. It is also a brighter timbre or tone quality, with more high overtones. A slower stroke of the same hammer produces a softer sound, which simultaneously is also more mellow, with fewer high partials. It is understandable that we might sometimes wish to vary the timbre, the tone quality, independently of the volume or loudness. But, unlike the violin and many other instruments, on the piano, if the pedaling is the same, varying the volume and the timbre independently of each other is absolutely impossible. Insisting that one can do this impossible task, often demanding also that our students struggle to do the same impossible tasks, is one of the most widespread myths in the whole world of piano playing. Indeed, there are many who would say that controlling tone and colors is the single most important task if we want to play expressively. Many people who believe that this is what they are doing actually play really beautifully, but that beauty is not happening for some of the reasons they think it's happening. So what actually does occur? What can we really control? Not counting pedal, ultimately there are exactly three variables for every note we play. One, when the sound starts. 2, how loud is it? And 3, when it ends. In the piano action, the corresponding considerations are 1, when the hammer first strikes the string, starting the sound. 2, how fast the hammer is moving at that moment, determining the volume. And 3, when we release the key, allowing the damper to drop back down and stop the string from vibrating. In addition, both the una corda pedal and the damper pedal do alter both the dynamic and the timbre of the sound, respectively by having the hammer strike only 2 strings rather than 3, and by raising all the dampers so other strings can sing along with those that were actually struck. The beautiful thing about this discussion, even if it might seem shocking at first, is that it lets us understand what actually happens from a facts-based standpoint. Secondly, those 3 technical aspects, when the sound starts, how loud it is, and when it ends, correspond directly to the most important ways that we have to be expressive at the piano. Those are rubato, dynamics, and articulation, respectively. What we subjectively perceive as differences in tone actually occur from the player's skillful coordination of dynamics, rubato, and articulation, along with the special effects the pedals can give us. So it's still fine to imagine orchestral sounds and being the conductor when we play a Beethoven sonata on the piano. That said, now we might have a clearer idea of what is actually occurring. In fact, this knowledge gives us more possibilities, not fewer. If we were physicians, we would notice when the sound starts and how loud it is as part of our technical diagnosis. Then we would adjust the timing of the next note, rubato, and the dynamic shape, volume, as part of our expressive prescription. That balance between hearing really clearly and then matching and adjusting what follows is a living, constantly changing process that gives meaning to what we do. A really useful guideline is hear first, play second. We need to know what we're actually hearing. Then we need to let that help us imagine what we want to hear next. Then we try to do what we imagined. And then the whole adjustment process repeats. My beloved teacher, Leon Fleischer, who passed away August 2nd, 2020, after a legendary career, often expressed a similar concept, that there are 3 persons involved in every performance. Person A is the executive who imagines and then decides what to hear, how to shape the phrase, how to dance the rhythm. Person B then needs to produce physically, through the keyboard and pedals, the best possible realization of what person A commanded. Person C, who sits in the audience, reports back to persons A and B about whether what B did matched what A wanted. On the basis of that report, person A then adjusts what to tell B to do next. That seems complicated, and in some ways it really is. However, it is also the simplest way that we can play freely from inside, rather than struggling with the impossibility of trying to remember all the facts about exactly how we are supposed to play each note of every piece. This gives us the freedom to create at the moment, which makes everything easier, more reliable, and a lot more beautiful. There are really 2 forms of music. These I call inner music and outer music. We can experience this difference first by playing a phrase on the keys, hearing the physical sounds as the outer music. If we then close the fallboard on top of the keys and play the same phrase again as expressively as we can, all that we hear physically is fingers tapping on wood and maybe some heavy breathing. But what we hear inside ourselves is the same musical phrase. Only now it is more beautiful than before. And without any mistakes or out-of-tune notes. Now it's your phrase. Did you hear it? Ideally, we decide how to play the outer music by having clearly heard the inner music first. The more accurately we hear our inner music, the better our chances will be of playing easily and beautifully the outer music. As the wise advice goes, hear first, play second. The inner music is the sacred and beautiful part of each of us. As teachers, we need to draw the students' awareness to their own inner music. We also need to think twice and then twice more before trying to force adjustments to someone else's inner music. Although, of course, there are many possible ways to hear a phrase. Almost always, if they're hearing it clearly, it's going to be beautiful and it's going to be right, even if it's a little bit different from what we would have chosen ourselves. More about that idea in a bit. The Austrian music theorist Erwin Ratz suggested a definition of the ideal listener as someone who knows every note of the piece, both in its local context and also in how it functions within the piece as a whole. But the ideal listener also retains the ability to be surprised by what he hears. There's a lot there to appreciate. This concept also provides valuable advice for how to play expressively. There are many levels of awareness through which we can appreciate each note, each phrase, and each section. Each note conveys meaning on many levels of thought at the same time. Also, what we have already heard in the music sets up expectations that are fulfilled by the expected, or surprised by the unexpected. This concept also informs our teaching. When we hear our student play the beginning of a phrase, we automatically form an expectation of how we would continue the phrase if we were playing it ourselves. Sometimes the student will play quite similarly or very differently from what we would have done. For that reason, we make rapid inner decisions. Could the phrase work just as well in an unexpected way, or do we need to make suggestions? What is the dividing line between offering appropriate suggestions and trying to micromanage every note of someone else's musical expression? It's often good to suggest multiple options, knowing that if the pupil makes informed choices, those are likely to be the right choices for that student at that time. It can require trust on our parts to allow that to happen. But good teaching very often means helping to expand awareness and to draw insights out from within the student rather than pouring facts and our own opinions into the student. The more we examine the many layers of rhythm, phrasing, and every other aspect of the music, the more we come to realize that there are too many possibilities for any of us to be able to comprehend them all, or to be aware of all the ways they interact simultaneously, never mind the total impossibility of controlling every level at once physically. We'll show some down-to-earth practical examples of this in a bit. The older I become, the more convinced I am that, since we cannot fully hear everything in the pieces we play ourselves, we do the right thing with our students when we point out the mysteries and the impossibilities, along with our opinions that this might be a good place to breathe between phrases, and that passage will probably be easier with this fingering and a relaxed hand. Many students want the answers and are perfectly willing to go practice whatever we suggest. This can be a valid way to learn, as they absorb whatever we can give, although it often also means that they're not taking full responsibility for their decisions. We do them a valuable service if we give them the tools to make the decisions themselves, and then lovingly push them away from too much dependence on our opinions, so they have to practice making those decisions themselves. After all, someday they're going to be teaching also. Where will they get their answers then? As the proverb has it, give someone a fish and he eats today. Teach him how to fish and he has enough food for a lifetime. Ultimately, our job is to teach in such a way that we become unnecessary, because we have already given our students the tools they need to teach themselves, and because they have already learned how to apply those tools in their own ways. We want them to develop the listening skills and technical awareness that we apply ourselves in our own playing and as we listen to our students. That is, when someone encounters a technical problem, we think, if I had played like that, what would I want to change to make it easier? That happens musically as well, as we trust our own inner guidance to know how to shape the next phrase and dance the rhythm. Ideally, we play because we love the music and we love our instrument and we love how putting the two together can help us feel. And we love to share those feelings with others who want to hear, including our students. There is a beautiful triangular relationship that develops between ourselves, the music, and our students. Each side of that triangle is a loving connection as each person, teacher and student, becomes closer to the music. They also develop a family connection between themselves. This is important and beautiful, no matter which composer we are studying. Thank you for your attention as we've looked at some of these ideas together. Let's turn now to some specific examples, many of which are intended to show multiple simultaneously valid ways to look at the same musical material. I believe that we can apply these concepts both in our own playing and in our teaching.
Thank you.
part of my own journey during the past few years has been the reality of having an uninvited guest in the form of excess bone growth in my left hand, a condition that my physicians have called carpal bossing. It's not from incorrect or excessive practice. It's extra bone tissue, not the nerves and soft tissues that typically are vulnerable to piano-related stress and trouble. My hand problem appeared very gradually, apparently as a genetic issue. But it causes enough irritation to the nearby tendons that I can no longer practice enough to play in public. This means, in turn, that much of my own music making comes now through the joy I feel in working with my students. As we look at several musical excerpts together, I'm very glad to welcome Xingyi Tsai, who will play some of the examples I want to explore with you. Xingyi, who is originally from Taiwan, is a doctoral candidate here at WVU and was twice named as a winner in our annual concerto competition. Xingyi has kindly agreed to help me connect words and ideas with musical sounds at the piano. Thank you, Xingyi. As I mentioned earlier, we'll begin by looking at Beethoven's first sonata, Opus 2, Number 1, in F minor. Let's hear just the first 8-bar phrase, which we'll then explore with a set of versatile musical tools that we can use in many pieces, not just this one. Thank you, Shanghai. Let's look first at the phrase structure. We see two bars, a similar two bars, and then a 4-bar phrase that leads to a fortissimo climax. This short, short, long phrase structure is almost a disease in Beethoven. Many of Beethoven's 32 sonatas open with such a phrase structure. The propulsive nature of the structure itself is part of what gives Beethoven's music its energy and drive, typically reaching a dramatic peak near the middle of the concluding unit, in this case, marked fortissimo. We often see this phrase structure on multiple levels at once. In measure 5 through 8, we see one bar, another similar bar, and a 2-bar unit that leads to its own peak near the end, between the 2 F naturals in the melody. Beethoven marks a diminuendo in the last 2 bars. How can I say that that was a peak? There's a powerful energy between the 2 F naturals. Despite the 2-bar diminuendo, the second F is probably at least a little bigger locally than the first F. It's a downbeat, it's longer, and there's a harmonic arrival in the bass underneath it. Here, as at the fortissimo, Beethoven fills in the energy between the notes with a melodic turn that corresponds to the arpeggiated chord in measure 7. We hear the connection even if we leave out the fillers. Let's also try the other one. Both of those places, Beethoven adds the turn or an arpeggiation, and I think what he's showing is the connection as we lead into the main peak. Can you play them again? Almost everyone will take at least a little bit of extra time during the turn, creating a small climax by using rubato. It's not unusual for the dynamic peak in this case the downbeat of measure 7, to occur before the rubato peak, approaching the downbeat of measure 8. Almost everything that matters in music happens between the notes. That statement is true technically. If we know how to leave note 1, we'll connect correctly and we will play note 2. It's true musically as well, in that beautiful pain we feel inside during a particularly expressive interval. The distance we travel hurts more than the notes. This helps us know what to do with the dynamic shaping and also the rubato by sensing the resistance between the notes. With both peaks in this phrase, we feel the most intensity right before the downbeats, not exactly at the beginning of the beat. Perhaps that's why Beethoven fills in the crucial intervals with an arpeggio or a turn. Both of those events pull us apart inside in beautiful ways. Almost all melodic intervals display some of that beautiful resistance, often varying significantly within a phrase. How much of this do we choose to show during a short motive, during a longer phrase, or within a whole section? In this 8-bar phrase, the short, short, long structure happens on two levels simultaneously, reaching individual peaks at different times within the ongoing structure. The smaller 1-1-2 structure occurs within the climactic conclusion of the larger 2-2-4 structure. That fact alone gives us reason to marvel at the complexity of this relatively simple phrase. It's also fascinating that Beethoven uses the short, short, long energy structure at least 9 times within just the exposition, 48 bars, of this first movement. Things happen on different layers rhythmically as well. Beethoven marks cut time, indicating 2 half-note beats per measure. Simple arithmetic tells us that each bar contains 8 eighth values, 4 quarter values, 2 half values, and 1 whole value. It's also enjoyable and appropriate to group whole bar pulses together in pairs of bars, as 1 pulse per 2 bars. Just as we can use first gear or 10th gear when riding a bicycle on level ground, so we can choose which pulse to use. We can also change the pulse, usually in multiples of 2, like shifting gears on the bike. Often a fast pulse, as with first gear on the bicycle, means our feet move rapidly and the forward motion is slow. This is helpful when climbing a steep hill, but would be very frustrating going downhill. Conversely, a slower pulse often means that we can move further with each pulse, and we're often more aware of the longer line in the music. I'd like to ask Xingyi to be very brave and play these bars thinking an active pulse every quarter note. Even if she does it really well, probably none of us will like it very much. Whew, I'm out of breath. And I didn't even have to do the work. Now let's try a half note pulse at the same tempo. That feels better, much less rushed and frantic. What happens if we try whole notes, 1 per bar? much longer lines, right? What about one per two bars? What a relief. It's easy to hear the whole phrase as one unit, and it feels much shorter because we're seeing more of an overview of the whole thing. It's a matter of perspective. Which way is right? Well, that question itself is a big problem. Even taking Beethoven's two per bar as the basic framework, there are advantages and disadvantages to each of these levels, and they're all happening at the same time. Ultimately, each layer is right simultaneously, but which pulse we choose to emphasize affects the music. I think we need to be free to change gears on our bicycle, depending on the terrain. Alfred Brendel speaks about pulse in these eight bars, using the term foreshortening. By this he means that we should double and then redouble the pulse rate as we approach the cadence. One per two bars, twice, one per bar, twice, and then two bars per bar to the end. Beethoven's beat pattern corresponds to what music theorists refer to as harmonic rhythm, the rate at which the chords change. In any music which is tonal, and Beethoven was one of the greatest masters of harmonic energy and dramatic tonal architecture, the bass line is in many ways more important and more powerful musically than the melody line. I like to say the bass is boss. It's often really helpful for students to sing the bass line out loud in whatever octave works for their physical voice. There'd be a really painful price for me to pay later if I asked Xing Yi to sing this bass line on video for thousands of viewers. So I won't do that. Instead, let's make a duet, and I'll emphasize the bass line while she plays the rest. Hey, that's a better deal than having to sing, right? As we play, notice how fast the chords change and how that contributes to energy and flow in the phrase. Emphasizing the bass has a huge effect on how the music holds together. Well, of course, we wouldn't actually add another voice to this piece in a real recital. If we explore this fundamental line in our practice, it can add powerful dramatic energy to our performance. With a composer like Beethoven, the energy of the bass line goes all the way through the whole piece. And it's the key to conveying the drama of the entire movement. The harmonies within a phrase have a natural energy and timing, and there is a sense of resistance to overcome on the way to a harmonic arrival point. In a similar way, the tonalities within a movement display a coherent sense of timing and drive, providing resistance and release as we approach an arrival point. In a sonata allegro structure, we usually end the exposition on the dominant, or sometimes the relative major. The development section will then explore various tonal areas, often relatively short and frequently changing, followed by a powerful sense of drive towards the dominant note in the bass, for example, C for a piece in F minor. Especially in the middle period, Beethoven often extends this harmony to great lengths, setting up huge anticipation for the resolution on the tonic at the recapitulation. Again, resistance and then release, but on a very large time scale. Before we leave this piece, I'd like to ask Shinni to demonstrate a technique I mentioned briefly before, playing the music on the fallboard rather than on the keys, but with full musical expression. This is to draw attention to the inner music, that beautiful ideal music that's inside our heads and hearts. I would invite you to notice what you hear within yourself as Shinni plays just the first 8 bars this way. Don't forget to breathe. Shinni understood this technique long ago, so you probably wouldn't hear much difference from before if she played it again now on the keys. But I can tell you that many, many times I have seen students try this technique for the first time with truly astonishing results. After shyly experimenting an initial time or two to get past the strangeness, when they relax enough to hear clearly what's inside their hearts, often for the first time ever, I have seen tears of joy and heard descriptions of getting chills or goosebumps from the powerful emotions they felt when they heard and trusted their own inner music for the first time. The results, when they then go back to the keys, can often seem truly magical. The point is, they have found their own magic in its pure original form, not just a clever copy of what I might have wanted for myself. In fact, when I've heard someone with reasonable skill try a piece and it seems as if everything is wrong, it almost always means that they're not aware of their own inner voice. We could try to fix each problem individually, probably causing lots of frustration on both parts. Instead, if, by playing on the lid, we take away all the worries about missed notes, perfect voicing, and doing all the right things, they're almost forced to figure out what they want to hear. After that point, maybe then one could make a suggestion or two about additional alternatives. But our student is going to be smiling. And you know what? In that situation, even though I might not have demonstrated even one note or said a single word about my own opinion, what that student plays when they really listen inside is almost guaranteed to sound strikingly similar to what I would have wanted to achieve after working really hard to fix whatever the various problems might have been. By becoming truly themselves, they touch my heart too. How is it that, without specific direction from me, someone else's playing can almost instantly, and almost without effort, become so similar to what I would have hoped they could achieve by working hard? Truly, we are all connected in amazing ways. Hearing that beautiful inner music can help to unlock some of the barriers, not only within ourselves, but also between ourselves and others. Let's look now at the opening of Beethoven's Sonata in F sharp major, opus 78. This piece comes from what most of us would call his middle period, even though it's much shorter, only 2 movements, than many of the neighboring sonatas, like Appassionata, opus 57, or Les Adieux, opus 81a. Through the lovely 4-bar introduction to the first movement of opus 78, we can explore interpretive principles that can be useful in many other pieces as well. With thanks to Shinhi, let's hear just the beginning now. Thank you. One of the things I liked, something that is probably the biggest technical challenge here, is the voicing. I don't want to spend a lot of time on that right now, except to observe that sometimes the secret answer is not what we think it is. In many pieces, I've asked students how they bring out the top voice rather than the lower voices. Frequent responses are lean the hand to the right or be firmer with the top fingers. It can be liberating to do the opposite. Listen more for the top and be looser in the lower part of the hand. The latter lets the weight of the arm flow into the top voice with less barrier and less tension. It also gives us a better chance to make a good legato connection in the top, depending more on a relatively shallow pedal for legato in the lower voices. Thank you. The first of the musical concepts I'd like us to explore is filling in, as Fleischer called it, a tool that is consistent with the idea that most of the musical beauty we hear happens not at the beginnings of the notes, but between the notes, especially just before the next notes begin. Resistance, reportedly a favorite word of Schnabel's, is part of that idea too. It hurts inside in a wonderfully beautiful way to move from one note to the next. And some of those distances hurt a lot more than others. By playing constant 16th notes in the melody as expressively as we can, we bring continuity to the long notes, and we sense in clearer ways both the expressive timing and the distances between the notes. Lovely. One of the features of this opening is that the space just before each downbeat feels especially tender. Let's try that again, filling in and including the first downbeat. Wait a minute. How can the first note be an arrival? Can we fill in during the silent upbeat? Actually, there's resistance there too, because it takes energy to get from silence to sound. The conductor gives an upbeat as everyone breathes in. Then the whole orchestra starts to breathe out again as the bows actually start to move and the wind sounds actually come to life. Again, lovely. A danger we face is that getting to each of the downbeats can be expressive, but we probably don't want to do exactly the same thing four times in a row. Try it again, and let's all listen for the relationship among those downbeats. There are many ways to prioritize. In addition to the pulse, we can look at the shape of the melody. It's tempting to say almost automatically, go to the highest note. Often that works, but frequently this answer seems too easy and not very convincing. Going to the high D sharp in measure 3 feels good. And Beethoven decorates that interval with a turn, just as he ornamented each of the two melodic arrivals in the beginning of Opus 2, number 1. Is that D sharp stronger than the following downbeat, B? It's not just the height of the pitch that matters, though. Would we really want the peak to be the last D sharp in measure four? Shingi, would you like to demonstrate several of these possible shapes, playing each as convincingly as you can? Maybe start with a relatively early peak, possibly the first D sharp, and then play again, aiming for a peak a bit later. I know that it's almost automatic for you to listen inside before you play, but it helps us all if we remember to be aware of that energy. In a way, that's what we're doing when we fill in those wonderful inner notes between the written notes. I thought each of those was beautiful in its own way. Do you have a preference between them? Years ago, I used this phrase of Opus 78 as material for a course I was teaching. Thinking about these possible goals within the melody, I borrowed from Shakespeare for the title of that day's lecture. To be or not to be. Now let's make it a bit more complicated as we dig a little deeper into how we choose to be expressive. Do you remember that we talked earlier about the three main ways we have to shape the music we play? Dynamics, rubato, and articulation are the big ones. Of course, we almost instinctively combine these elements, but it can be really enlightening to experiment with using them independently from each other. That can also be very frustrating because it feels unnatural. For example, can we be expressive if we only use dynamics but no rubato? Or rubato with flat dynamics? Actually, playing that way is a lot harder than it sounds, but trying to do it can open our ears to what we're actually doing. We also become a lot more aware of how much of each element we've been using. Shingi has tried this before, so she'll probably do pretty well. Most of us fail miserably, though, the first time we try to be expressive with no rubato anywhere. Would you try playing 16th notes with all the dynamics you want, but metronomically constant in the 16ths? Good for you. It's so easy to add a rubato, even when we try not to. Now please try the opposite, using lots of rubato, but playing each 16th as close to the same volume as you can. Good. That's really hard to do. It's just not possible for either one to feel really natural. But both exercises quickly show us how to be more aware of the expressive techniques we're actually using. For example, we might say to ourselves, I like how I'm playing this, but I want to try using more dynamic contrast and a bit less flexibility in the time. Suppose one of our students really, really likes rubato, maybe too much of it, like making a whole meal out of chocolate. If they're playing Chopin or even a Beethoven slow movement, they're not going to come back for any more lessons if we try to tell them they can't use any rubato in this piece. That could get expensive. But the rubato that we're hearing is way too much, and somehow we have to fix it. Of course, that was deliberately too much. But it's very interesting that on the most local levels, everything she did made sense. What didn't work so well was the big picture. We were so distracted by all the busy stuff right in front of us that we couldn't see the view. In other words, that performance was simultaneously quite good in the very local connections, and also not so good because it was harder to hear the big line. A very helpful tool in such cases is what I call rubato rationing. It goes like this. Use full natural dynamic expression, but allow yourself only one rubato in the whole phrase. That's harder to do than it seems, especially for folks who are addicted to gooey, chocolatey, constant rubato. First, listen inside to decide where you really have to have that one precious retard. Of course, what this does is help prioritize where the most important rubato just has to happen. Shingi? I counted at least three. It feels so good, we can't help ourselves. And I think that's a wonderful part of music making. Try it again. Be a little tougher on yourself. Allow only one rubato. Why don't you show us where you're going to put it?
In the turn.
During the turn. Yeah. Job. Well, I'm actually feeling really very generous right now. So how about this time you allow yourself two rubatos? How will you balance them? Will you take more time during your first choice and a little less during your second choice? Or maybe the opposite of that? Why don't you show us where you're going to take the second one?
Actually, I will have here, A sharp to you.
Before the B. So everything is kind of happening between the second and third bar. Okay. Beautiful. How about doing one more? If we go to three, where would you put the third one?
Right here.
At the end? Yeah. Let's hear that. Beautiful. Of course, we could go on to four or more with various ways of ranking them. But you get the point. Another huge factor has to do with layers of pulse. Almost always, an excess of local rubato means the player isn't aware enough of the larger pulse. For example, one per bar in this phrase. Changing the tempo can also help to reduce the excess. Instead of constant 16ths, try playing this excerpt a bit faster, with one rhythmic pulse per bar. Which of the four downbeats will get the most delay? What has happened, of course, is that we've just explored a really effective way to prioritize. Was this most recent performance rhythmically expressive, not metronomic? Yes. Did anything feel distorted? Well, there's room for disagreements about details, but probably it was not distorted. That is because a deep layer of pulse was clear, essentially one per bar, while also being flexible. If the deeper layers are right, the little stuff on the surface, for example, the flexibility in 16th notes that was way too much a bit ago, will naturally fall into place. One of the quickest ways to see the big picture is to simplify. Many of us start a new piece by learning all the notes and then adding the expression. That works, but it's often hard work. An alternative that's often useful is to find the music first and then add the notes. Playing on the lid, easier, of course, if we already know the piece by ear, playing just the melody and or just the bass, conducting the score, all are useful. Fleischer often said that after he left Schnabel, his own best teacher was to sing the material. There's so much contained in that simple statement. If the singer's breath or the violin bow stops moving, the sound immediately stops. This means that music wants to flow horizontally, not just up and down motions of the keys with added crescendos. We have to choose which horizontal line to sing each time, whether it's the melody or the bass or some inner part we want to get to know a little better. Complex material can be simplified in three primary ways: horizontal divisions, vertical divisions, and changing the tempo. Each of these can let the music seem much less intimidating almost immediately, letting us avoid repeating the same mistakes again and again because the material is too complex to read or understand clearly at first. Playing or singing just the melody or the bass, rather than the whole vertical texture, is a tool I call horizontal simplification, as if we've drawn a line between the voices and then we play only what is above or below that horizontal line. There's much less to comprehend and coordinate, with the result that we can make beautiful music almost immediately in that line, rather than struggle to play all the notes and not do any of them very well. If instead we draw vertical lines in the score, we can choose just a few notes at a time, or a measure at a time, or a phrase at a time. Each choice is much easier than playing the whole first page, which is far too much to remember clearly when we go back to try it again. In fact, the whole page will probably sound just as bad the second time. But if one measure doesn't sound significantly better the second time we try it, we probably weren't paying attention the first time. Systematically practicing fast passages and short bursts up the tempo with deliberate fermatas and physical relaxation every few notes will let us experience how it will have to feel technically at full speed. At the same time, the short units and the fermatas let us experiment without doing the sort of messy, too fast practice that every piano teacher warns against every day of the week. After horizontal simplifications and vertical simplifications, the third tool is varying the tempo. Half of that is similar to what we just described. It helps a lot to practice fast pieces at slower tempos, so we really know what we're doing and can hear the music clearly rather than approximating and developing lots of sloppy habits. Sometimes we need to combine slow practice with either horizontal or vertical simplifications or both along with the tempo change. Anyone who learns the fugue of the Hammerklavier, Opus 106, is just about guaranteed to use all three forms of simplification simultaneously for quite a while before anything makes sense. We usually think of technical virtuosity as being able to manage fast scales or octaves or double notes or counterpoint, often in very showy ways. In that context, the Hammerklavier fugue does return to mind. Another way to define virtuosity is to be able to say, yeah, that's easy. Okay, maybe not the Hammerklavier. What this means, though, is that a very helpful guide for whether we're practicing well is whether we can say honestly, really honestly, this is easy. Think about it for a moment. Of course, we want our playing to be good, and that's an appropriate goal. But sometimes we're grateful just to get through something on stage without falling apart, to have it sound fine, even though we were dying inside. In that case, it might have sounded good, but it definitely was not easy. The other side of that same coin is that if something feels genuinely easy, and we're loving it, and being truly honest, it's very likely also to be really good. If something easy is usually good, but something good, at least on the surface, might not be easy, then it follows logically that seeking easy in practice is often more efficient than seeking good. Back to tempo simplification. Consider the opposite of the piano teacher's favorite mantra, thou shalt practice slowly. It's often very helpful to practice slow pieces at faster tempos than we intend to perform them. In a slow movement, there's usually no big technical problem other than voicing. But memory will be an issue, and the biggest problem is flow. If we can't convey movement within a slow tempo, everyone falls asleep. In a slow tempo, if we play just the melody, or the melody and bass, as beautifully as we can, but significantly faster, even very complex material almost instantly becomes a simple song, easy to memorize and flowing effortlessly. The point is that once we've heard that beautiful long line clearly at a fast tempo, we can keep a lot of the flow when we return to the normal tempo, because we now know where we want the peaks to be. Also, don't forget about the valleys. Let's try that technique in, of all things, the sublime ethereal theme of the variation second movement of Opus 111, the last sonata. Having written this, which was my doctoral dissertation at Peabody, and having played the piece more times than I can count in many countries of the world, please know that I love this music very dearly, as does Xingyi. But I'd like to ask her to do something that initially might seem terribly wrong and out of place, almost sinful. I'd like her to play just the theme, without repeats, definitely with love, but twice as fast as it should go. Please don't judge. Whatever we do now is temporary, and it's for a good purpose that will become clear. Do you feel guilty? Nah, my teacher made me do it, right? Seriously, though, would either of us ever want to perform it at that speed? Of course not. And some of the faster material later in this movement would be totally unplayable at this tempo. So what's the point of doing this to something so beautiful that Beethoven has marked adagio molto? What was much easier to hear, precisely because of this crazy tempo, was the shape and flow of the whole theme, which at normal tempo can easily seem very long, even for a good player. At a normal slow speed, at first we often are able to hear only the short local phrases and can easily lose our way, seeing lots of leaves on the trees, but having no idea about the forest. And we'll probably be doing lots of worrying about voicing too, because we're very exposed here. And anything that's not just right will certainly be heard. All these worries are valid, of course, but everything truly will be a lot easier when we really know clearly where we want those voices and harmonies to go. At this fast tempo, you might have noticed that the theme has two halves, each of which is divided into two parts. Three of the four-bar units reveal the short-short-long structure that we saw in Opus 2, Number 1, written so many years before this. By contrast, the second four-bar unit feels more like two balanced halves rather than short-short-long. Harmonically, we have the purest C major imaginable, played with hands wide apart, as if ready to hug the whole world. That brings to mind a line from the Schiller text that Beethoven set in the Ninth Symphony. Seit umschlungen Millionen diesen Kuss der ganzen Welt. Be embraced, ye millions. Share this kiss with the entire world. The third phrase goes to A minor with a darker feeling, but returns powerfully back to the shining, timeless light of C major at the end. It's also interesting that the most likely melodic peak in each four-bar phrase occurs at a unison, in principle, the most consonant of all intervals, just as in the final peak in measure 8 of Opus 2, Number 1. Let's play it again, maybe even a little faster, so the phrase structure is really clear. At this tempo, it's much easier to feel the meter, too. A serious misunderstanding can happen all too easily in this piece if we start by reading this theme too slowly before we're ready for that. That first beautiful melodic C over a root position tonic triad is the first event we hear. But it is most definitely not a downbeat. It's an upbeat that has to lead to the second G in the melody. Nothing can possibly make sense in the deeper layers of rhythmic flow, in the theme, or in any of the variations, if we hear the first sound as a downbeat. Let's try it again, as fast as you like, with a clear feeling of one per bar, which is also subdivided as three per bar. It might help to breathe on the missing downbeat in the upbeat bar, or to count 1, 2 in tempo before coming in on 3 and flowing to the downbeat. Thank you. Of course, it's not just a sequence of four-bar units. It's pairs of bars, four-bar phrases, and eight-bar halves. Each half has to be repeated. Thinking that way puts small units together to form larger units. If we play each small unit well, does that mean we'll play the whole theme convincingly? Maybe, but probably not. The whole needs to be more than just the sum of the parts. To play this theme well, we need to be able to comprehend an entire 32-bar unit, including the repeats as continuations, that is both perfectly proportioned but also flowing towards clear goals. This lets us see the large structure, after which it's a whole lot easier to see each of the smaller units in clear perspective. Within the variations that follow, whenever the material of the theme is present, which is most of the time, with several amazing exceptions, how we understand the theme itself to flow is a natural expressive blueprint to follow as we explore each variation in turn. The phrase structure and harmonic flow will basically be identical to those of the theme. So when we really understand the theme, we already know the deeper expressive content of each variation and can be more ready to enjoy the changes in the details with much less probability of getting lost. The first time I visited Tokyo, Japan, about 30 years ago, one of my WVU students was a very kind and generous host. He also drove me several times through narrow, winding streets from his parents' home to the music school I was visiting. I was totally lost every time because everything was so active and busy and confusing, and all the street signs were in Japanese. Perspective problem. If I could have observed that car's journey from an airplane, I would have quickly gotten a sense of where it was going, if not necessarily every turn along the way. After such an overview had become clear, then a helicopter might have helped as a next step to understand more of the local turns without being overwhelmed again by the immediate traffic and forgetting where we were going. Of course, I could only see the trip from the perspective of my student's car, and walking would have been worse. It often seemed intimidating. But again, it's a matter of viewpoint. Many times we have to start with the small and work up to the big. Sometimes, though, we can save ourselves a lot of time and trouble by starting with the overview, of course simplified as necessary. Then we'll have a much better chance of understanding the smaller units without losing our way. Someone once asked Arthur Schnabel why, for someone of his ability and fame, he played a relatively limited repertoire, which did, of course, include all the Beethoven sonatas, among many other great works. Schnabel's answer puts everything into perspective. I am only interested in music that is greater than it can ever be performed. What Schnabel shared in that simple sentence is a beautiful approach to life and to living with Beethoven. It is sincerely humble and yet quietly confident at the same time. Knowing in advance that we'll never play perfectly, even if we do happen to get every note right sometimes, actually frees us to do better and to understand more deeply, by giving us a much higher perspective. It's all about the music, which can carry us and all who are receptive to a better place. Abandoning perfection does not mean that anything goes, so why worry and why practice? Instead, we do our best to understand more each day, but without the guilt of trying and failing to do something that was actually impossible from the beginning. Living deeply the reverence for the music that Schnabel expressed, with much less concern about ourselves, can let us fly higher than we ever thought we could. As we fly higher, the air becomes thinner, but we can see farther than ever before.